Exactly. There are,
okay.
There.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Mm. Very exciting.
Okay, much more than excited. finally. How long is the training, please? 1 hour and a half. The answer is 1 hour and a half.
Yes.
We'll take 90 minutes.
Mm. Yep, here, let me.
Yeah, it's there. Because I don't.
Okay, I think we can start in time.
We can start, so no, okay, exactly. We need to respect the time. Huh? We need to respect the time, but we are waiting for the signal by dawn. By dawn, dawn. Where we are?
She's ready. It's all set, Umberto. She's got the recording going.
Okay, and so we start.
Yep.
We start? Okay. Okay. Welcome to everybody. This is the first webinar organized by the European Chapter of Eating Disorder. We are very excited, using the words that normally use my great friend, Elisa Meyer, because today we listen to the lesson by Riccardo Dallegrave. But first of all, I want to introduce a little bit the European chapter. Me, I'm Umberto Nizzoli. I'm the president, the European president of the European chapter. And we are working to enlarge our presence and our credibility in Europe because we need to strengthen more the relation inside Europe to help people affected by eating disorder and their relatives to receive the most qualitative care. And so we are do many things. For example, we organized the European conference. Remember that European chapters was born in the 1918 along the first conference in Rome. And nowadays we are organizing the seventh European conference this month in Alpbach, Austria, Friday 21. But you can read also something about Europe inside the newsletter, and you also try get in touch with us using the web of eating disorder of European chapter eating website, and also the page of Facebook. Remember, the page of Facebook is most important for us to get in touch with you, but you can use also Instagram and Twitter. Remember, website of European chapter and Facebook page of European chapter. And now I'm introducing Riccardo Dallegrave. He's a friend, he's a very important researcher and clinician. He's a doctor, he's the director of the Department of Eating Disorder in the Hospital of Villa Garda in northern part of Italy, in Verona, to be exact. His research within the department has addressed many aspects of eating disorder and obesity. Remember, obesity is a topic that is interesting for us, and we'll organize next, in some months, some webinar on it, including their diagnosis, maintenance mechanism, assessment, and treatment. In collaboration with Professor Fairbairn, he has developed an original inpatient treatment for eating disorder based entirely on enhanced cognitive behavioral therapy, CBTE, and an adaptation of CBTE for young people with eating disorder. Riccardo Dallegrave is particularly interested in assessing the effectiveness of CBTE in adult and adolescent patients with eating disorder who are significantly low weight in both outpatient and inpatient settings. Is editor of the official CBTE website and director of the Italian Advanced Training Course on the Treatment and Prevention of Eating Disorder and Obesity, which trains clinicians in cognitive, behavioral, therapy for eating disorder. He also supervised many services and units in different countries in Europe, but also in the US and in Australia and the Middle East. He's author of more than 170 peer review articles and books, including the two recent books, Cognitive Behavioral Therapy for Adolescents with Eating Disorder, edited by Guilford Press, 2020, and Cognitive Behavioral Therapy for Eating Disorder in Young People, A Parent's Guide, very important, Routledge this year, 2022. He's fellow of the Academy and is member of the European Chapter Board. And so welcome, Ricardo, to introduce this first webinar of the European Chapter. After his presentation, there will be the opportunity to pose to him some questions. Please, Ricardo.
Thank you, Umberto. Thank you for your nice presentation, and also to thank you to all the members of the European Chapter that gave me this important occasion to share with you an update of CBT for young patients. Also, take the occasion to thank Elisa for is crucial and support to us, to the European Chapter, and also for organizing this webinar with you. I go directly to the topic because I want also to leave space to questions that you can put in the chat, and I'll be very glad to discuss with you all the issue regarding the CBT for adolescents, but in general, the treatment for young patients. I see many colleagues and also many friends among the participants. Many of you are expert clinicians in eating disorder, and we know that we treat a disorder, eating disorder, and anorexia nervosa in particular, that is a disorder that has a profound impact on the physical health and psychosocial functioning of the young people. So there is a general agreement that it is crucial to treat the anorexia nervosa early and effectively, because otherwise we can see some people that have a long-lasting duration of a eating disorder with a dramatic impairment in the life of a patient, but also of a family. We know that a particular form of family therapy, termed the Mosley therapy or family-based treatment, according to the US definition, is the recommended leading empirically supported treatment intervention for young with eating disorder. However, as all the treatment we have in eating disorder, family-based treatment has some limitation. First, it is not acceptable to some families and patients. And most of all, in the best randomized trial that assess the efficacy of FBT, only about 40% of the patient achieve a complete remission from the eating disorder. So, as also Jim Locke and other colleagues of family-based treatment affirm, we need to modify family-based treatment or to make it more acceptable but effective, or we need other type of approach. In this webinar with you, I will propose, and I hope I will be able to convince you that CBT is the most actually valid alternative to FBT. In this webinar, I will cover four main topics. The first is to give some general information on eating disorder in young patients, and this permit me to explain you why we adapt CBT, that was a treatment developed for adult patients, also for young patients. Then I will give you a general overview of CBT of young patients, but I take also the occasion, because it is very important, to discuss with you the differences and the similarities between CBT and FBT. And there are many differences conceptually, organization involvement of the patient and the family. And I will finish discussing the effectiveness, the data we have on the effectiveness of CBT for younger patients. If we see to the eating disorder psychopathology, when I speak about the eating disorder psychopathology, I refer to the attitudes and behaviors that you see specifically in eating disorder, but you don't see in other mental disorder, like, for example, the over-evaluation of shape and weight, the strict dieting, the self-inducing vomiting, the laxative misuse, binge eating episodes, excessive exercise. They are shared between older patient and younger patient. And you know, people that has been trained in CBT knows that CBT was specifically designed to address the specific eating disorder psychopathology and its maintaining mechanism. Even if we use a more modern way to think and to assess the psychopathology, that is the network approach, here we see a study recently published in the International Journal of Eating Disorder using this approach by my colleagues and Simona Calugi, that is involved in the development of the adaptation of CBT for eating disorder. We study in this research 1,265 patients with anorexia nervosa and 382 adolescent. You see, I don't want to go in detail. However, also with the network analysis, you see that the shape over evaluation, the feeling fat, the desire and weight loss, so the core psychopathology of eating disorder according to the CBT, are the most central and highly interconnected nodes in the network, both in adults and in adolescents. And you see it's very similar, the network between the young and the adult patient. And there is a similar structure also, especially in nodes related to eating behaviors and in nodes about body mass concern. And this form two distinctive clusters. Even if we use a more traditional classification of eating disorder, so the DSM classification of eating disorder, you see that all the eating disorder diagnosis according to the DSM-5 are present both in young patient and in adult patient. This is a recent study that we made. I was curious to look at the number of patients seeking treatment before the pandemic and during the pandemic. And here you see in the graph that there was a dramatic increase of seeking treatment, especially in the young patient between 15 and 17, and a decrease of seeking treatment patient over the age of 25. And even if there are some differences in the percentage of DSM-5 diagnosis, you see there is a young patient receive more frequently than adults the diagnosis of anorexia nervosa, and less frequently the diagnosis of bulimia nervosa and binge eating disorder. And they receive more frequently the diagnosis of atypical anorexia nervosa. However, what I want to underline with you is that all the DSM diagnoses, not just the psychopathology, but all the DSM-5 diagnoses are present both in adult and the young patient with eating disorder. However, young patient presented some important distinctive feature. One is that most adolescent patients are highly concerned about issues of control autonomy, but we think that this is not a major problem for CBTE, because the CBTE, if you know the treatment, it was specifically designed to enhance the patient's sense of control and autonomy, because it is a very, very collaborative approach with the patient and therapist work together to overcome the eating problem. One of the most difficult part, aspect of to treat eating disorder in general, but especially a young patient, I will return on this topic when I describe CBT, is that most adolescents are very ambivalent about the change. They are in a very egosyntonic phase of their psychopathology. However, this aspect is not a major obstacle, because CBT was designed to be very engaging, and specifically, especially in the first part of the treatment, was designed to address the ambivalence towards the treatment. And also, the psychopathology is not completely developed in young patients. You can see young patients that do not report the fear of weight gain in the early stage of the disorder, but what we call the over-evaluation of eating control per se. Also, this is not an obstacle of CBTE, because the body image module can be adapted to address the over-control of eating, overeating per se. Another distinctive feature that make us to adapt the treatment was that we need to involve most of the time the parents in the treatment, and this required a modification of the treatment. The adult form include what they call the significant other in about one third of patient. Here we include most of the time the parents, and also we need to match the treatment to the cognitive development of the young patient, but also this, we realized that it was not a major obstacle, because CBT is not a complex treatment to receive by the patient. What I want to underline, and we never forget this when we treat young patients, that the physical health is particularly concerning our patients, so we need to do always a careful and monitoring medical assessment, and in my opinion also to have a lower threshold for providing a more intense intervention like inpatient treatment or hospitalization. Now I go to give you a general overview of the younger CBT. If you want to have more detail about the treatment, I suggest this lecture. Is a book, is the manual, the actual manual that is indicated for young patients, but it includes also an update of a general strategy and procedure of CBT. You know, the original book was published by Chris Faber in 2008. This was published in 2020. How we design and implement the CBT. This is the Villa Garda Hospital. I see some colleagues that came to visit Agnes. It's in a nice place to live and to also to work. And I had the opportunity to implement a randomized control trial on the adaptation of inpatient CBT. At that time when we developed a trial, we had not Zoom. And this was, I was lucky for this, because Chris Faber came every month in Italy to give a supervision to the trial to discuss the adaptation of outpatient to CBT to inpatient CBT. And during the discussion, we were younger here, me and Chris Faber, and I started to discuss with Chris why we don't adapt also the treatment for young patients. You know, if you see the recommended treatment for young patient, start from the concept that the young patient need an external control. I will discuss more later when I do the comparison between CBT and FBT. So at the beginning, there was some skepticism that you can use an individual approach like CBT also for young patient, an individual approach that has the goal to actively involve the young patient in the treatment. And even if I, at that time, I didn't use CBT with a young patient, but I use what I can say a broad cognitive behavioral therapy of eating disorder. In my experience, I started to work with patients with anorexia nervosa in 1984, almost 40 years now. I realized that it is not true that you can't engage the young patient. If you, with some strategy, also young patients that are in a very egosyntonic phase of their eating disorder psychopathology can be engaged and be actively involved in the treatment. So I started to discuss with Chris this possibility. It encouraged me a lot and it helped me a lot to develop the adaptation of the CBT that I remember you that was originally designed just for adult patients, not for the young patient. And to give an overview of CBT, CBT for young patients has four main goals. The first, and it is crucial, and sometimes it's the most difficult obstacle to address, is to engage the patient in the treatment, in the decision to start the treatment, but also to become active in the process of change. And this is a distinctive characteristic of the CBT. Then the goal is to remove the eating disorder psychopathology and extreme weight control behavior, but especially the mechanisms that are maintaining the psychopathology. And finally, and this is another original strategy of CBT, to help the patient to develop specific skills to maintain change and to prevent the relapse. I can't go in detail explaining the treatment, so I just give an overview of the general strategies that we use in CBT for young patients. One of the most important steps, and we start doing this also in the preparation, the assessment and the preparation of CBT, is to educate patient about the differences between what we call the medical model or the disease model or the eating disorder and the psychological model. CBT is designed on a psychological theory on the maintaining mechanism of eating disorder. Then after we have educated the patient on the someone had to turn off the audio. It's typical.
Exactly, Ricardo. Someone that has the micro open and so they can make noises.
So once we explain the differences between the disease, the medical model, and the psychological model, we help the patient to become curious about the psychological mechanisms that are maintaining the eating disorder. I say to my patient to reach a better condition to assess the implication to stay or to change. But before, you have to have a comprehension of the psychological mechanisms that are maintaining your eating problem. If at the end of this stage of a treatment that lasts from 2 to 4 weeks, if a patient reaches the conclusion not to change, the treatment stops. because it's not a treatment that obliges the patient to change. But this is not common. In the trial, we had almost 8 to 9 patients decide to go in the step two that we call the addressing the change in psychopathology. What we say now to the patient, now I use the same word that I commonly use in my clinical practice with the young patient. And after asking the patient if do you think that your control of body weight and shape, the low weight, is a choice or is a problem, but without going in detail in this discussing, I discuss with the patient that one of the major questions that open to different way of thinking of eating disorder is why a young patient like you, for example, continue to adopt a strict diet and extreme weight control behavior to lose weight and change the shape of the body shape despite all the impairment, not just physical but psychological impairment. It is clear that is a question that requires an answer, okay? And to explain this to this answer, in the field of eating disorder, there are two main models, one and two categories of model. One, we can say the disease model, and the other is the psychological model. To explain what we call the egosyntonic nature of some expression of eating disorder. When I refer to egosyntonic, I refer to the behaviors, values, and feelings that are in harmony with or acceptable to the needs or goals of the ego or consistent with one's self-image. And you can easily understand that some feature of eating disorder satisfy the definition of egosyntonic, the low weight, the strict dieting, the exercises, excessive exercising, but also what we call the over-evaluation of shape and weight. In other words, they don't see this expression of eating disorder as a problem, but as an achievement. This is one of the most difficult aspect of eating disorder psychopathology that it creates an obstacle to engage the patient. To explain the egosyntonicity, the disease model uses a simple explanation. Say, these features are the expression of a specific illness. And according to the collection of attitude and behaviors, an illness can be anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, binge eating disorder, or other eating disorder. But it is clear that the medical model, the illness disease model, has an important implication in the treatment because the goal is to defeat the disease. And as the classical medical model, the patient is passive. We say, the medical model typically say to the patient, you have two parts in your mind. One is healthy, the other is ill. You have not to trust to the ill part, and you have not to trust to your thought about shape, weight, and eating, because they are the symptoms of your disease, of your illness. And you try to follow the indication of the doctor, of the psychology, dietitian. And the clinician use also a collaborative, but especially prescriptive approach. And the patient, I will return when I will describe the differences between FBT and CBT, are controllers. They control the behavior of their child. On the other hand, the CBT is a treatment that was developed on a psychological field. So it uses a psychological model to explain the maintaining mechanism of eating disorder, but especially the egosyntonic feature of eating disorder. And according to CBT, you know that patient has a difficulties to see dieting and low weight as a problem because for several reasons, their self-evaluation has become predominantly based on their shape and weight and eating control. And we use the description of this core psychopathology with a pie chart in which you see there is a predominant slice that is the shape and weight and few other slices. In other words, this represents the importance that the people gives to some area of their life, in this case, the shape and weight, in the self-evaluation. But this is different from the self-evaluation of a person without a eating disorder. This core psychopathology explains the other egosyntonic feature of eating disorder, because if a person evaluates themselves in terms of shape, weight, and eating control, we can understand why the patient doesn't see strict dieting, excessive exercising, other extreme weight control, and low weight as a problem, but on the contrary, when the patient is able to diet, to exercise, to lose weight, this is associated with what we call a sense of realization. So we can give a psychological explanation why the patient maintains a low weight despite all the negative effect, physical negative effect, psychosocial effect. So this also has another implication in the approach, because using a psychological model like CBT, CBT never use prescriptive or coercive measure, and therefore it is a treatment that never ask the patient to do something that the young patient doesn't agree to do. So the patient is helped to understand that their system of self-evaluation is not only associated with environment, physical, but especially in a young patient, interpersonal environment, but is dysfunctional in reaching stable and good self-evaluation. And so the patient is actively involved to find and to work in a collaboration with the therapist to find more functional solution. So if we summarize this implication, the goal is to change the self-evaluation, to develop a more functional self-evaluation. And in this work, it is clear that the patient needs to play an active role and work in a collaborative way. We call collaborative empiricism with the therapist to work to address the eating problem. And the clinician is not a prescription, doesn't prescript the change, but help the patient in understanding the psychological mechanisms that are maintaining the eating disorder, and to develop with the patient a better comprehension and to help the patient to use some strategy and procedure to address this psychopathology, but also especially the maintaining mechanism. And at the same time, the parent is not a controller, but is an helper in creating an optimal family environment, but also in supporting the child to implement some procedures, but with a previous agreement of the child. This is completely different with the approach of a family-based treatment. Then when the patient is engaged, we address the eating disorder psychopathology with, we address the eating disorder psychopathology using a flexible and personalized series of cognitive and behavioral strategies and procedures integrated with patient education. However, we privilege the behavioral change to obtain a cognitive change, and we encourage the patient to become curious, to become an expert how the eating disorder is working according to a psychological explanation using what we call the real-time SEM monitoring. And then the patient are asked to make a gradual behavioral change on eating, on weighing, on body weight shape, another behavioral expression of the eating disorder to analyze the effect and the implication of the way of thinking. So in other words, we try to change the attitude and cognition, changing some specific behavior included in the personal formulation of the patient. In the later stage of the CBT, when the patient comes in the session and start to say us that, I realize that I spend half a day without thinking about shape, weight, and eating. In this part of the treatment, the approach changed completely, and we use some strategies to help the patient to recognize the early activation of the eating disorder mindset and to decenter from the eating disorder mindset to prevent relapse. And so if we describe graphically the general strategy, it is clear that the goal, the final goal of the treatment is to reduce the importance that the people give to the shape and weight in self-evaluation and develop a more articulated and functional self-evaluation system. However, if you see, and we discuss this with a young patient, if you see this diagram, it is clear that if you want to reach this condition, you have to address first to address the low weight and the strict dieting, because this, with several mechanisms, tend to maintain this self-evaluation. And this is not easy, and this is one of the difficult parts of the eating disorder treatment, but especially CBT, because the patient has to decide to address low weight and the dieting when the low weight and dieting have an extreme positive function for the young patient. So they are the solution. And this is the reason why we dedicate the first part of the treatment not to address weight regain or the change of eating, but helping the patient to reach a common comprehension of the psychological mechanisms that are maintaining the eating disorder and decide to address in the step two, the low weight, the dieting, and also the over-evaluation of shape and weight and other psychopathology that can be present. The organization of the treatment includes two treatment, pre-treatment assessment and preparation. Then we have 30 to 40, 50 minutes individual session and three post-treatment review session after 4, 12, and 12, and 20 weeks. This is what we call the MAP. We have the assessment and preparation. We assess the psychopathology of the patient, the severity of the psychopathology, but also we engage the patient not to change, but to start what we call the step one of the treatment. Step one of the treatment is a treatment that can last from 2-3, maximum 4 weeks, where the goal is to help the patient to reach a psychological comprehension of the mechanisms that are maintaining the disorder, and especially to give a psychological explanation of the egosyntonic feature of the eating disorder, and to dedicate some session to decide to address or not the eating disorder psychopathology, and if a patient is low weight, also to address the low weight. If the patient decides to change, the patient go in the step two, where we address the eating disorder psychopathology, but also if the patient is low weight, we help the patient to address the low weight to reach a minimal normal body weight that is not associated with impairment and it is not the maintaining mechanism of the eating disorder psychopathology. Every 4 weeks, we do what we call a review session, where we review in involving actively the patient, the change, the improvement, and the obstacle of the previous 4 weeks, and together we decide how to address the obstacle and which psychopathology address in the following 4 weeks. Then we have the last part of the treatment, the step three. Here the session are once every 2 weeks. In the first part, we do a twice session a week, where the goal is to help the patient to conclude the treatment, to develop skills to prevent the relapse.
69.
Yeah.
Where does the money go?
Sure. And after the end of the treatment, we have three post-treatment review session after 4, 12, and 20 weeks. These are the core procedures of the CBT. We call the core procedures because they are the procedures to address the eating disorder psychopathology. And if you want to use the CBT, you have to become an expert in the strategies and the specific procedures that are included in specific module. This means that not all this psychopathology is addressing with the patient, but is adapted to the characteristic of the patient. One of the distinctive aspects of CBT is that it's a treatment very flexible and personalized. It's a tailor-made on the characteristic of the patient, because we address the psychopathology operating in the patient, not the disease. So the engagement of the patient, the help the patient identify and analyze relevant phenomena using real-time recording. We work on regular eating. And in the first part, we help the patient to decide to choose or not to weight regain. If they want to go in step two, we address the psychopathology that is operating in the patient. And here we have different modules. We have a module for the low weight, a body image module that works in addressing shape and weight concern, a dietary restraint module that addresses extreme and rigid dietary rules, and also a what we call event and moods and eating module to address the events and the associated chain emotion that influence eating. And then towards the end of the treatment, there is a module, what we call a setback module. And the goal is to help the patient to identify setback and to respond promptly to them. And at the end, there is the step three, where we conclude the treatment and prevent relapse. All these modules and the strategy and procedure are well described and detailed describing the main guide. And after, we have what we call 4 external modules. These are modules for people that, in addition to the eating disorder psychopathology, have what we call, according to the CBT terminology, external maintaining mechanism. We can also use the definition non-specific maintaining mechanism, because these are psychopathology feature that operate in also in another mental disorder. And we have 4 modules: the clinical perfectionist module, the marked interpersonal difficulties, the core loss self-esteem, and the mood intolerance. And usually we don't include one more than one module, and we use this external module in less than 30% of the patient. Okay. So the standard treatment for about 60-70% of the patient is the focus form of CBT. We use this module only when they are pronounced, they appear to maintain the eating disorder, and seems likely to interfere with the response to treatment. So if a patient is responding, is improving with a CBTE, we don't broaden the treatment, but we stay on the focus form of the treatment. just finished the book also for the young patient, and is a manual for the patient. It will be published next year by Routledge, and I wrote this book with my colleague Simona Calugi. And because one of the goals of CBT is to educate the patient on the psychopathology, the psychological mechanism, but also on the procedure, for example, how to do the self-monitoring in real time or the relevant mechanism of eating disorder. But then we ask the patient read, for example, how to use self-monitoring in the manual, okay? Or how to read out the personal formulation in the manual, how to use problem solving in the manual. And during the COVID, we had more time, and it was difficult to see the patient face to face. So we might call Simona Calugi, she's in front of me. She's now, she's laughing. We had more time, so we decided with Zoom. It was very easy. We developed many video, educational video for the patient. You can see the video, but they are in Italian. There is an Australian group that is translating the video in English. And now actually we already developed 6 video. One is to explain how to do the real-time self-monitoring. The other is the collaborative wagging, the regular eating, how to use a questionnaire that we develop, the eating problem checklist to assess the psychopathology week by week, how to use the proactive problem solving, and also how to monitor the body checking. The parents' involvement, there are 2 general strategies. I work a lot with Karina Elkazan, that she's a colleague of Middle East that is actively involved in the Academy of Eating Disorder of Middle East, how to adapt to include the parents in the CBT. And I have no time. You can maybe in the future have a webinar with Karine. She's an expert and can speak hour and hour how to involve the parents in CBT. However, there are 2 main goals. One is to create an optimal family environment, okay? And the second is how to support the young person to implement some procedures of the treatment, however, with the previous agreement of the young patient. So the goal is to involve the parents as a helper, not as a controller. Usually we do 1 session only with the parents to educate the parents of eating disorder, especially on the psychological model of eating disorder and how to create together we discuss create an optimal family environment, and especially also to address some potential barrier, parental barrier to change. And then we develop what we call the jointly session with patient and parents at the end of the individual session to inform the parents about what is happening in the treatment, and then to discuss, as I told you before, with a patient prior agreement, how to help the patient, for example, to prepare the food, to consume the food during the meal, how to be helped to conclude what they plan to eat, and also other strategies and procedure of the CBT. For the young patient, we develop some educational video for the parents, and we develop 5 educational video. 3 videos are information on eating disorder. The first describe to the parents the difference between the disease model and the psychological model of eating disorder. We discuss also the potential causes of eating disorder, what we know, but especially what we don't know about the causes of eating disorder, but focusing on the maintaining mechanism of eating disorder. And we give an overview of the CBT. Then there are two videos that, in our opinion, are the most important, that we include strategies to create an optimal family environment and how to support the young patient to implement some specific procedural treatment. This is the book that I wrote with Karine El-Kazan. It's in English. You can see all the parent involvement in the CBT, how to understand the eating disorder, but especially how to help your child that is attending, is doing CBT. Then I go to discuss briefly the differences between CBT and FBT. If you want to have more information, you can read this paper that I wrote with Daniel Lagrange, that is one of the most important authority of FBT, and Sarah Eckhart and my colleague Simona Caluggi. I am a good friend of Daniel Lagrange, and I like to work with him because we have a completely different idea on the eating disorder psychopathology, how to treat young patients, but we are very collaborative, and we respect each other. The goal is not to do a sport competition between the two treatments, but to understand which is the best treatment for this specific patient or not. So we made the first study at the Children's Hospital of Minneapolis, and now we supervise together some unit in Australia, and our goal is to finally to do a randomized control trial comparing FBT and CBT. However, summarizing in this table the main differences between FBT and CBT are related to the conceptualization of eating disorder. And the conceptualization has a very, very important clinical implication, because according to FBT, the problem belongs to the entire family and the illness is separated from the patient. We call this process externalization. It's not your fault, it's not the fault of your parents, is you have an illness. The illness is anorexia nervosa, okay? So you have this behavior, this attitude, because you have an illness. CBT, the theory of CBT underlines that the problem belongs to the individual, okay? There is a schema, the over-evaluation of shape and weight, and we never separate the illness from the patient, but we try always to understand what are the function of some expression of eating disorder. Okay, never say you have anorexia nervosa, you are so why you diet, because I diet because I have anorexia nervosa. We try to help the patient to understand what is the function of the diet and what are the maintaining mechanisms of the diet. So we never separate the illness for the young patient. And this has an important involvement and implication in the involvement, because both of the adolescent and of the parents, because in FBT, the adolescent are not actively involved. On the contrary, it's crucial in CBT to actively involve the young patient, and on the contrary, for FBT is vitally important to involve the patient, and in CBT it is useful, but it's not essential. Okay. However, there are also some similarities. I discussed a lot with Daniel the similarity, and the first is that both treatments address not the potential causes, but the maintaining. And I think this one of the main reasons of the success of the two treatments. The second, and this is another important aspect of the two treatments, both have a major focus to help the adolescent to normalize the body weight. Okay. It's crucial both for FBT and CBT. And also we have regular weighing using completely different procedures. In CBT, there is what we call collaborative weighing. The patient knows the weight, is actively involved, also in interpreting the change of body weight. And maybe, as Hillebrand underlined, it is possible that there are some common mechanism of action. For example, the exposure and habituation to fear food and consumption, it is possible. But also we think that both treatment indirectly with some strategy reduce the over-evaluation of shape. In CBT, we work a lot in helping the young patient to develop other domains of life. An FBT in the later stage of the treatment help the patient to become more autonomous from the parents. And then both treatment manage comorbid psychiatric diagnosis. We include the psychiatrists in the team, hospitalization in case of unstable condition, sorry. And when the patient is can be managed safely. Safe way outpatient. The last part of my presentation, so we have also time for question, is to discuss briefly the effectiveness of CBT for young patients. I don't go to describe all the studies made by my team. We made mainly of our studies were in real world settings, so our effectiveness studies. We made two studies in outpatient adolescent with anorexia nervosa, and published. The first one was in behavioral research and therapy, and we report the data of about 50 patients, and we promise the result. And in the title of the paper, we say maybe it is an alternative to family-based treatment. And Terry Wilson, who was the editor of the research and therapy, published an editorial of this paper. And then we repeat after 6 years, we study in real world with psychologists that were not involved in the research, but only trained in CBT. We made also a study on not underweight patients, and this was that's important. We compare the outcome of CBT in adult and in adolescent. And what we found that not only CBT works also for young patients, but works better than the adult form. We have a greater percentage of patients that normalize the body weight and in a shorter time in comparison with the adult form. And then we also made two studies in patient CBT applied to young patients with anorexia nervosa and inpatient CBT that compare the adult and the young form of inversion of eating disorder. What I want to discuss more in detail, however, is a study that I made made by the Children's Hospital of Minneapolis, and I supervised the CBT, and Daniel Legrand supervised the FBT. It's not a randomized control trial, because it isn't, however, in my opinion, is an interesting new way of doing study. What they made, the colleagues of the Children's Hospital of Minneapolis. When the parents seek treatment for the child, they say to the parents, we have two treatments that are effective. One is family-based treatment, the other is CBT. And they describe the two treatments, and they gave also two handouts explaining the two treatments and the difference. The difference between the conceptual difference, but also the involvement of the parents of the young patient. And it was interesting because what was the first finding? That the parents of younger patients chose the FBT. However, on the contrary, the parents of older adults from 15, 16, chose the CBT, a more individual approach. And also there was difference on the duration of it. Was longer in the parents that choose the CBT, and also in the previous treatment that was significantly more previous treatment in the patient that choose the parents that choose CBT, and also the impairment and the psychopathology was more severe in the parents that choose with the child. The parents with a child that choose CBT. In other words, the parents that had an older adolescent with a greater number of previous failure and a more severe psychopathology, they choose the CBT. However, the results were completely similar between the two treatments at 6 and 12, even if the FBT slow weight regain was more rapid initially than the CBT. But this is related to the different strategies of the two treatments, because in FBT, you start the increase of body weight from the first week. In CBT, in this trial, we start the weight regain after 4 weeks. Now we try to start after 2 or 3 weeks. However, in this trial, we start after 4 weeks. But what is the most important, at 6 and 12 months of follow-up, the outcome was similar both in body mass index and the change of eating disorder and general psychopathology. So summarizing the effectiveness studies in this study, we can say that CBT has been shown to be suitable for the treatment for adolescents with anorexia nervosa. 72% complete the treatment, and among completers, about 60 have a complete remission of follow-up. And also, I have not the time to discuss the adaptation to CBT to rehabilitation and inpatient setting. We have also promising results because the completers rate is even greater, 85%, and among completers, about 62%. Have a normal body weight at follow-up. And these patients are all patients that failed previous outpatient treatment. So I can conclude that CBT is effective in a real-world clinical setting and can be an alternative to CBT. This result led the NICE guideline to suggest the CBT for eating disorder, CBT that I describe you as an alternative to family-based treatment, if it is in efficacy. This is in Italian, sorry, I let an Italian slides, okay. But this was an important aspect because now the young patient has two alternatives. They have not just the FBT, but can have another alternative. And in my opinion, this to have more options that show to be effective in the treatment of young patients is very, very important. I conclude with this last slide. What is the future research? The research that I am involved in, and also our other colleagues are involved. We think that one of the most important challenges clinical field of eating disorder, especially the treatment for young patients, is to clarify the relative efficacy of CBT and FBT in a randomized controlled trial. It's not that, I think, and I discuss a lot this with Daniel Lagrange, it's not the goal to win the gold Olympic goal, to see this is better than the other, but we need absolutely to understand what are the moderators of a treatment response. In other words, this family, this patient has more possibility to recover with family-based treatment or CBT. But we can answer only to this important clinical question only if we do a randomized controlled trial comparing, and we are working with some grant, and I hope that we will finally have this grant. We failed three grants before for to compare this treatment. But now I am a little bit optimistic because we had a dramatic increase on the incidence of young patients of anorexia nervosa. And it is clear that we are not just to dedicate clinical resource to treat this young patient, but also to study the treatment in a randomized control trial to invest money in doing research to understand better how our treatment are working. And I think it is possible to find moderators of change because they are completely different in the conceptualization of the eating disorder, the strategy to change, and the involvement of the patient and the parents. And other aspects are related to my research, or my group, is to understand better what are the role or not just of the eating disorder psychopathology, but also of the other psychopathology in the treatment outcome, to understand if what other psychopathology we have to address with the young patient, and we have no study on this. And also, we are very interested in to understand the reason of non-response, and maybe if we do randomized control trial, also the mediator of the effect of the treatment. Actually, we don't know the active ingredient, both of FBT and CBT, and this is a lack of knowledge of our field of psychological treatment. We also don't know the optimal duration of CBT. There are some patients that respond very early and they go in remission. They don't seem to need very long treatment, but we don't have many data to follow up. But some patients maybe require a longer duration of the treatment, but we have no data to do. And finally, this is my work with my colleague, is maximize it optimal implementation. I am not a big fan of a reductionistic approach of psychological treatment. I think that we treat a severe psychopathology, we need training, we need workshop, but also I realize in these last 5 years that I made a lot of supervision that clinicians need to be supervised if they want to implement well the treatment. And also, to implement well the treatment with my colleague, Susanna Strabel, Rebecca Murphy, Zafra Cooper, and Simona Calugi, we develop a therapy self-rate CBT component checklist. These are all the strategies, the general strategy and procedure of CBT, and is a checklist for the therapist because we think that this can help the therapies to improve the fidelity to the treatment, and so to improve a better implementation of the treatment. If you want more information about CBT, you can go in the CBT website, where there are information for patients, for parents, but also for clinicians and researchers, and there are a lot of instrument measure articles where you can download, and also we also include all the workshop training on CBT. And I conclude thanking of my colleagues of the CBT working group, especially I have to thank Simona Calugi and Christopher Fabel, but Rebecca Murphy, actually the leader of the Credo Oxford for Eating Disorder, Christine Bond, Zafra Cooper, with Christopher Fabel, the originator of the CBT theory of eating disorder, and expert clinician like Massimiliano Sartirana, that is working with me, Suzanne Strabel, working in New York, and Christine Bond. Thank you for your attention. Now I think we have 20 minutes of time for all the questions.
Oh, Ricardo, it was a wonderful presentation. It's very helpful for clinicians because they have the skills to face the eating disorder in a well, good management style. Thanks a lot, Riccardo, but you came from the most important excellence center from Italy. And so you have a great experience, not only a great research. We have the opportunity to speak to some questions to Riccardo, and until now we receive. There are somebody that write and
many questions.
I try to post to you. Me too, I agree to debate with you. It's very important, your presentation is very suggestive also. First question is, what training for clinician is from Jennifer?
I can read the question.
You can read also.
One question is important. The question is, can a registered dietitian implement this treatment? And if so, what training should we undertake, given we are not psychologists? It's clear that this is a psychological treatment. So, you know, my suggestion is that should be delivered by psychology or mental health that can deliver psychological treatment. However, in my team, another team that use CBT, we develop what we call the multidisciplinary, not eclectic team, where we train also not psychologists, like dietitian, nurses, medical doctor in CBT. And for example, we can include having a dietitian that is training in CBT can be of great value, for example, to address the low weight module, that address not just with a prescription, the typical prescription of the medical model used by the dietitian, but with a CBT dietitian that address the low weight and dietary restraint and restriction with CBT strategy and procedures. The same in the inpatient unit with the assistant eating. Okay. And also to address some specific requirement of the patient that has some allergic or celiac disorder or other gastrointestinal inflammatory disease. So the goal, however, is if you want to do well the CBT, is that all the team is training CBT, and we call non-eclectic multidisciplinary team. That is different from the multidisciplinary team that works on the medical model, the disease model, where there is not an integration of the theory and the strategies, the terminology, and also the goal of change. Okay. Another question is, when I had a teen on CBT, they did not like to complete the real-time monitoring and sometimes they drop. Any advice? It is clear that this can be an obstacle, okay? But if I can give you a suggestion, you have to create curiosity in the young patient, because from the beginning, you instill the idea that there are some psychological mechanisms that are maintaining the disorder. And I work on the psychological mechanisms because I have a psychological model of explaining the disorder, not a disease model. But I need your help. I need your help, absolutely, because you have to observe yourself in real time. I know that is difficult, but to observe how this psychological and behavioral mechanisms are working. And this is not a food diary, because sometimes the mistake is that you ask to monitor the food. And many young patients made this the food diary with a dietitian, for example, or other. But here is an instrument to understand how the eating disorder is working, how the psychological mechanisms are working. And we relate the content of the self-monitoring with the personal formulation. And this is crucial. So it's not just do the self-monitoring, but to prepare, to give a rationale to use the self-monitoring. And we also ask the patient to do an experiment, understanding the difficulties, that In the first part, you can increase your preoccupation, but you can, with this instrument, not only to understand better how your eating problem is working, but you can change something, some behavior that seems automatic and impossible to change. You need patience, you need patience, you know. You need, you know. Okay, other question. What would you consider appropriate for CBT for adolescents with comorbid diagnosis of autism? If so, what modification would this require? We don't have what we call predictor of change. So we don't know if it works or not, but as other comorbidity, I can say. Because one of the problems is to understand the mediator. So I have a different opinion in comparison to the guideline. I try always a psychological model as a CBT with a young patient, because even if it doesn't work, the patient is not engaged, has difficulty to understand the mechanism, is not changing. This is a treatment that adheres to the medical principle primum non nocere, because it's not a coercive approach. Most of the patient, also the patient that decide not to change and are not able to change, have a good experience with CBT, because they work with a clinician that was interested in understanding the positive function of eating disorder, in helping to understand the psychological process containing the eating disorder, that not forced to change, but offer the opportunity, the treatment as an opportunity to find more functional solution. Okay. And it is common also to see, and also many colleagues on CBT report this, that after the failure of CBT or deciding not to address the change, they come back after 5 or 6 months and say, now I am ready, I want to change. So it is a treatment that helps to the collaboration. And also it is easy. It is easy because also the homework, the things, you can adapt the treatment to the cognitive capacity of the patient, because you try to achieve a cognitive change through gradual behavioral change that the patient can do. We never ask the patient something that they don't see as a problem and something that they cannot do. Okay. So this is one of the general strategies of CBT. What is the lowest stage of young people? We included young patients from the age of 13, but in clinical setting, we have also patients of 12, but depended by the cognitive development of a young patient. It is clear that it is a treatment that fits especially young patients from 15, 16, 17. Remember that is the peak age of onset of eating disorder. Okay. And also, I take an occasion also to discuss an aspect that is in discussion, especially in UK, to have a treatment that, you know, address also the transition from the young age for the adolescent to the adult age. One of the problems of the clinical service is that are separated the adolescent service and the adult service. So what happens when the patient has 18 years, has to move from the adolescent service to the adult service? But this transition is dramatic sometimes, because maybe sometimes the patient has to wait some months to start the treatment and move from a treatment where was completely managed by the parents as the treatment we deliver in the young patient to an individual treatment, like is the treatment that we deliver to adult patients. So CBT implementing in a Transdiagnostic age group can, as in my clinic, in clinical service, can overcome one of these obstacles. Is there any feedback for parents, FBT versus CBT? This is another interesting question. We didn't made a qualitative study on the two treatments. It is clear that what we are studying and is the transition between the two treatments. Because, for example, both in Minneapolis, but also in the clinical service in Australia, where they use CBT and FBT, is common what they call the transition from one treatment to the other. For example, they start FBT, the FBT fail, and they move to CBT. We recommend that different therapists use different treatments, but the most difficult aspect of the transition is the different involvement of the parents and of the patient. Because, for example, a parent that is engaged to have an active role in the treatment, to manage the meals, the control of the food, has difficulty in adapting in having a different roles as the helpers. And also, the young patient has difficulties in change the way of thinking about eating disorder. From a medical model, I have an anorexia nervosa, but the implication of thinking in an illness model, medical model, is also speaking the terminology, the involvement in the treatment, and the transition in a psychological model like CBT, where the young patient is very active. I don't think that the patient are unhappy or one treatment or another treatment. The important that the treatment should be based on a solid theory, and it is clear what is the role of the parents. Okay, and it is clear that the parents are happy if a treatment works, you know. And so we have, in my opinion, we have also to explain that to the parents that it is not possible to have a 100% remission of the eating disorder, but it is important to work well in the treatment with solid basis, with strategies that have a rational. Okay. This is important, not just to give help without theory behind. Okay. This is, I think this is very appreciated by both the parents of FBT and CBT. Another interesting question is why is so great increase of atypical anorexia nervosa. This is related to two main reasons, in my opinion. The first is that we had an increase of overweight and also obesity in the young. I read just yesterday the report of obesity in Italy in young patients is about 1 in 4 young people is under the age of 12 is overweight, excess of weight. And you know that overweight and obesity is a risk factor of eating disorder. And when they start to lose weight, they have a dramatic decrease of body weight, what we call weight suppression. So they have all the features of eating disorder, but we start from the overweight and obesity. The second aspect is, I think, is an improvement in general, that parents take the children before than in the past. When I start to treat young patient with anorexia nervosa in the 18, the 19, the parents take the child when they were in an extreme and severe undernutrition. Now, the parents, but also the doctor, you know, the coaches, the teacher, are recognized early the eating disorder, and this is important. So we have Many patients that satisfy also the diagnosis of atypical anorexia nervosa because they reach the clinical survey before going in underweight. Do you treat eating disorder and SUD? What is? I don't understand. Substance use disorder? No. However, here we have one of the maximum experts in Italy of substance use disorder, that is Umberto Mizzoli, our president. But in CBT, we treat patients with intermittent substance use disorder. So, for example, they use disorder during the weekend, but they are free during the week. But is a contraindication to treat patients with stable daily substance use disorder because it doesn't work with treatment, because the patient should be should be able to think and not influenced by the effect of a drug. So we refer this patient to colleagues that are expert in treating substance use disorder. SD, autistic spectrum disorder. We had a good experience with, I would like to know better. I hope that the European chapter of eating disorder in the future will include also a webinar discussing this important topic, the association with autistic spectrum disorder and eating disorder. Is an important topic, but we don't have good research. And also remember it is important to do a good differential diagnosis, because the effect of under-eating, underweight, the social isolation, the social indifference sometimes is exacerbated or maintained by the low weight and under-eating. So this is an important recommendation to be expert in the psychopathology of eating disorder, the effect of malnutrition, starvation on the psychopathology. Not to everyone, thank you, Jennifer.
Hey, thanks a lot, Ricardo. I very much to continue our debate. I'm so lovable that I want to continue, but it's difficult because time is over. Thanks a lot. It was a very useful webinar for all the clinicians. And so thanks, Ricardo. Thanks a lot. And I want to thank also Simona Caruggi, this in face of you, that worked with you many times and they published with you many articles. And so thanks to Villagarda, to Ricardo, for this kind of presentation. Before to close the first webinar of the European chapter, I want to thank also Lisa Meyer. She's very helpful for everybody. She is a guest for our webinar today. And so thanks, Elisa. And also thanks, Dawn Gannon. She's very important for our technical support with our air. It becomes difficult to stay in touch with so many people as today. And I want to remember that the next webinar should be November 17 at the same time. We'll debate about LGBTQA and eating disorder. Welcome. Thanks a lot again to everybody and to Ricardo specifically.